Starlee Kine is a longtime contributor to and former producer of the public radio program This American Life. Her considerable archive of story contributions to public radio emphasize her use of the medium as an instrument to craft rich narrative experiences full of humor and surprise. The stories Starlee has told on This American Life use audio of compelling conversation interlaced with her keen narration. These stories include authoring a love song with the help of Phil Collins to cope with heartbreak, the trash and treasures found in Andy Warhol's vast collection of objects, doing stand-up at a karaoke bar, her obsession with reruns and being a child star, and convincing her parents to get a divorce. These true stories are about Starlee's life, and they're about Starlee encountering other people's lives. But they always transform audio of the everyday human experience into sensorily vivid stories that reveal the pitfalls and triumphs of curiosity and discovery. Starlee's podcast Mystery Show was named the best podcast in 2015 by iTunes and tackled and solved such age-old mysteries as how tall is actor Jake Gyllenhaal and why is Britney Spears carrying a book you can't find and no one has read. These real-life mysteries may seem only to solve trivial conundrums, but even mundane equivocation and uncertainty in our own lives can have a way of propelling us forward with a thirsty craving to experience the visceral satisfaction of coming to a factual conclusion. And anyone who has lost and then found their keys knows this roller coaster of emotion quite well. In addition to This American Life and Mystery Show, Starlee's writing has been featured in the New York Times, and her true stories about almost joining a cult and waiting for artist Marina Abramović were told at the live storytelling event, The Moth. She has been interviewed by Vice and Vanity Fair and appeared on Conan with Jake Gyllenhaal and tape measure in hand to really get to the bottom of that case. She's currently a contributing writer for a TV show called Search Party about a woman in her late 20s taking on an unsolved case of a missing former college acquaintance. More akin to Columbo than Sherlock Holmes, Starlee's mystery-solving skills originate in human connection and intimate conversation. In her work, hearing is not simply a mode of ingesting information. It's a way to deeply connect with her subjects with authentic empathy, drawing out their individual stories. So now, let's hear from her. Please join me in welcoming Starlee Kine.
I was a failed child star, not a child star. Failed. Never happened. Hi, Denver. You have very nice lighting in this city. I mean, outside, but also inside. The light bulb wattage is really pleasant. It feels a little bit like a conspiracy to lull me to sleep. Like, it's weird. Okay. I find it very hard to talk about my work, not because I'm shy or afraid of public speaking. I obviously crave attention, but I do like doing it because it makes me think, have to think to myself about it, and I feel like I would never do that otherwise. It's the same reason I invite someone over to my house before it's clean, so I have to clean it. But the reason I find it hard is because it involves me telling stories that have already been told, even if the stories have been told, I was the one who told them originally. I find it really difficult to ever tell the same story twice. A story I wanted to tell you guys was how I originally got into radio, which I didn't mean to get into radio at all. It was a total accident. I had never heard public radio until I was on it. It's true. I used to do the interns, I used to choose interns at This American Life. I was an intern and then I used to choose them. And there used to be all these applicants who would write to me and say, their whole lives they had grown up listening to it. And it was just the natural trajectory, and I did not relate at all. And I usually didn't hire those people because I couldn't. I think they thought that's what I wanted to hear, and to me it was alien. I had never heard it. And I was working, I went to college in New York, and I had this neighbor, I lived in the East Village, and I had a neighbor who, this old lady, who thought I was a drug kingpin. She fully thought I was in charge of the whole operation, and she used to try to she would hang up signs on the back of rave flyers saying my apartment was number 3, saying apartment 3 selling drugs here, and she would stick them strategically up around the building to try to alert the neighborhood of the threat that was in their midst. And and there was no evidence, I wasn't doing anything, but she was convinced that I was hardcore, just in charge of it all. And she used to plant kid trash in the hallway to try to frame me. She would collect it from somewhere and there'd be Hostess cupcakes and candy wrappers and stuff that she would just put right outside my door to try to maybe that would be the thing that would get me out. Not the selling the drugs, but maybe the trash. And I became really obsessed with her, and she became really obsessed with me, and I ended up doing this, making a doc, a video, I barely want to call it video because it was before cameras made things look good. It was such a crappy documentary about her. And then I worked at a bookstore, and I used to, after work, have people come from the bookstore and watch the movie, and then the reason I wanted them to watch in my apartment so then we could go in the hallway and she'd be out. We had doors like this, doors right next to each other. And she'd be, we'd go in the hallway and she'd open her door and shine a flashlight and close and open the door while shining a flashlight. And it was really scary and really satisfying that she did it every time. Her craziness was so predictable. And one of the people that I showed that to had this friend, his name was Paul Tuff, and he was starting to help create a radio show called This American Life, which I'd maybe heard of it the day before, but it was nothing like it's now. And Paul came over and I kicked my roommates out of my house so I could see grown up and pretended just in case so he wouldn't find out. And then he came over and then he started interviewing me, and I was so excited by the fact that it was weird because I had never even there wasn't so much storytelling stuff back then, and This American Life wasn't around long enough to create the thing that now is ubiquitous. And so I didn't have any model for it, but I felt it felt so inevitable that he was going to be there interviewing me. I was, of course, this is my life. This is what happened. I just tell stories, and you make stories about my life. And then Paul asked me what I wanted to do, basically when I grew up, and I was I'll just follow you to wherever, to this place. And that place was This American Life, and then I became an intern, and then I became a producer. And so that's kind of my origin story, but I feel even as I'm telling it to you, I have to force the words out of my mouth because it's the story has now become, it's a good story of how it started, but it's so familiar to me now. And I find it, I really truly find it hard to tell a story that I know that well. And there was a article in the New York Times a few years ago about this woman who had gotten, she got a fugue state amnesia, real actual born identity amnesia. And she wandered around for 3 weeks missing without her wallet and without her keys and without any money. And they finally found her in the water swimming because she had just walked for 3 weeks and then had walked into the water, and she just, all she knew was to move forward. And there was this detail about how she'd gone into an Apple store in her fugue state and logged into her email, and then the emails came up But she didn't, and there were all these emails being like, where are you, where are you? We were so worried, but she didn't understand because she didn't have any sense of self. So she couldn't understand what the emails meant. But her hand, the muscle memory of her hand had typed in the password. Like her body had remembered like her identity in a way that she, like her mind hadn't. And I feel like when I tell a story like that, it's kind of like muscle memory, right? Like I know all the beats. I know you guys were going to laugh at the kingpin part and the flashlight part, although it didn't get as big a laugh as I thought, the flashlight part. But like, and I feel, and I'm, and I, it, you, it's kind of comforting, you know, it's like this ritual, but at the same time, like it really is, like I feel like what I'm constantly struggling with and trying to find is how to kind of, to achieve that balance of once I find a story, after it, not abandoning it once it's like actually being, it's actually been told. Because what's interesting about stories is, what, like, this is what I learned at This American Life. What's interesting is that that story I told you, kind of, stories often come out into the world fully intact. Like, they're kind of like, more like little baby horses than they are baby humans. Like, they can walk pretty much right away. And what I learned at This American Life right away was I would go and do a story, and I would get all the tape, and I'd come back, and I would like tell Ira or one of the producers or a friend, and I would just be recounting it. And every single detail that I told them was the stuff that made it into the story in the end. Like the bones were there from the very beginning. And I never get tired of telling the stories before it's a story, but then once it's a story, it's like, it's kind of like this full life force, like the life cycle has been completed, and then I find it hard to ever replicate. And I feel like from the very beginning when I was doing This American Life stories, I was really consumed with doing original stories that hadn't been told before. And I honestly don't even know if I feel this is a preference because it is, I find it so hard to not, to. It's harder to find stories, I think, when you like never want to retell either your own story or someone else's. And so like I would do, in the beginning, the way I would tell original stories was I would do stories about my life. So I knew those stories hadn't been told before because I would be the one telling them. And so like I heard someone gasp about how I made my parents get divorced. It was really for the best, I swear. It was totally for the best. It was a long time coming. And so I would do a lot of stories about my family and about little things I had observed in life. And then sometimes my favorite stories to do though were like, I never wanted to do just personal, kind of personal ones without a concept attached. Like I liked it when there was two things. I liked there to be a purpose of why, even though it felt original to me because no one had told it, I still wanted there to be a reason why I was doing it, like something to find out. And so like in the case of the one about my parents' divorce, I wanted to find out why my dad had stayed with my mom as long as he did, why they'd actually stayed together because they were so unhappy. And then I did a story about my breakup. I went through a breakup, and I'm going to play you some of that now. Maybe you guys have heard it. And this was really to get closure. Like, I felt like when I thought of this, like, I went through this breakup, and I was really, really in bad shape. And the minute I thought of doing it as a story, it wasn't like I got better at all, but it was like I knew it had to, I had to see it through. Like, it was the only, to me, it was like the only logical sequence of events was like your boyfriend breaks up with you, you think of a story, you do it for This American Life, and maybe you heal at the end. And like, I just didn't like know what else, how, maybe they've destroyed me and I don't have regular coping mechanisms. I did start working there really young, but so this is how that one starts.
Before I explain why I decided to write and record a breakup song, even though I have no musical ability and can't play an instrument of any kind, I should probably explain a bit about the breakup itself. It was only after Anthony broke up with me that all the warning signs I had missed came sharply into focus. Like the time he told me he didn't like taking pictures of girlfriends because it was a downer to have those photos around once the relationship was over. I'd had a crush on him since the day we met, but he always had a girlfriend in Canada. Then she broke up with him and we got together. A week after that, he told me I was the one, which, in retrospect, was probably the biggest warning sign of all. It was hands down the corniest relationship I've ever been in. And by corniest, I mean greatest. We'd pass entire evenings just complimenting each other. We took hand-holding to new heights. and we listen to hours and hours of music, teenager style, playing one song after another while smiling a lot. I don't quite remember how our Phil Collins phase began. I think it was one of those things that started off ironically, with Anthony lip-syncing, adorably, to Against All Odds one night. But over time, it became less and less ironic, until one day we were actual fans.
How can I just let you walk away? Just let you leave without a trace? When I stand here taking every breath with you. Ooh. You're the only one who really knew me at all.
We liked how honest and sad it was. How can I just let you walk away? Just let you leave without a trace? You're the only one who really knew me at all. We pictured Phil Collins at the piano, writing it, the tears running down his face.
I wish I could just make you turn around. Turn around and see me cry. There's so much I need to say to you. So many reasons why.
Anthony broke up with me on New Year's Eve. I told you, corny. I didn't really see it coming, and I definitely didn't want it to happen. He said, "You're going to be okay." I just cried and cried. I wanted to stop it, to fix it. I searched deep inside myself for the right words to say, and out of my mouth popped this. "How can you just let me walk away? I'm the only one who really knew you at all." And I meant it. In fact, I go so far as to say that in that moment, no one could have conveyed how I was feeling better than Phil Collins. If I thought I'd been in a Phil Collins phase before, it was nothing compared to what came next. I was no longer listening to his songs for pleasure, but for pain. They were breakup songs, and hearing them was the only thing that made me feel better. And by better, I mean worse. There's something so satisfying about listening to sad songs. They're like how you would actually be spending your day if you were allowed to just break down and sob and grab hold of everyone you met. They make you feel less alone with your crazy thoughts. They don't judge you. In fact, they understand you. A breakup song won't ever suggest you start online dating or that you're better off without him. They tell you that you're worse without him, which is exactly what you want to hear because it's how you feel. I didn't want to be cheered up. I didn't want to bounce back. I didn't want to meet someone new. I wanted to wallow, big time, deeply, and with the least amount of perspective possible. And the only way to do that was by turning off my phone and turning up the sad, sad music.
Hi.
Okay. So I decided to write a breakup song because I had no choice. And I needed to get help because I didn't know how to do anything. I still can't. Like, I really tremendously have like a psychological block about music. You guys should know this too. Like, it's very ironic that this is probably my best known This American Life story. Like, music totally is so confusing to me, and I don't even sing alone or anything. But yet I knew I needed to write this song in order to get through this. So then I went to an expert who,
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Starlee. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you great. Phil Collins, of course. What, is that weird? I got it into my head that it'd be great to ask Phil Collins how to write a breakup song. The same way you might think to yourself, I'd really love to talk to Michael Jordan about free throws. I never thought it would actually happen. Then, against all odds, it turned out I had a friend who was on a road with Phil Collins, on his Genesis reunion tour shooting footage for the DVD extras. He gave me his contact info, and I sent him an email. "Dear Mr. Collins, I have a rather unusual request." Then I waited, refreshing my inbox every 3 seconds. When his email finally appeared, he was friendly and casual. We set up a time to talk. In my mind, he was already so intimately involved in my breakup that it seemed crazy that he didn't actually know about it. So I told him. Well, I'm gonna tell you the whole story of my breakup and stuff, okay? Is that okay?
Yeah, it's your 45 minutes.
Okay. Well, it also involves you. So I was dating, my boyfriend, Anthony, and he kind of broke up with me on New Year's Eve.
Oh, nice.
Whereas before it was Anthony and I talking about Phil. Now it was Phil and I talking about Anthony. Actually pretty tidy when you think about it. And at one point I turned to him and it just flew out of my mouth. I just looked at him and I was like, I can't believe you're just gonna let me
walk away.
Yeah. Before long, Phil Collins and I were commiserating about heartbreak, which he also went through recently.
So, I mean, I've just been through a marriage breakup, and you talk about New Year's Eve. I mean, my divorce is final on my birthday.
Oh, really?
And I didn't want it at all. So that's something that, you know, you always remember these things, you know, like you'll always remember New Year's Eve, and I'll always remember my birthday.
I know. It makes you want to skip those days, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Up until this conversation, I never thought I had much in common with Phil Collins. He started playing in Genesis at the age of 19. I didn't. He performed in Live Aid, while I only watched it on TV. He was in the movie Buster, which I never actually saw. But talking to him was easy. He told me that when he was in Genesis, he just played drums and sang. He didn't write. Against All Odds is one of the first songs he wrote himself when he was working on his first solo album.
That song particularly was written during my first divorce. Mm-hmm. My first wife and the kids had gone, and I was just left there. So it was written totally out of experience, as opposed to this is a what-if song, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Do you think you could have written that song if you hadn't gone through, if your wife hadn't left?
Probably not. I mean, frankly, if that personal stuff had not happened to me at that mm-hmm. time, I probably would never have made an album. And if I was to have made an album, eventually, it would have been more of a jazz rock thing, because that was what I was actually, that was my output. Apart from Genesis, I was in a band called Brand X. And that's, you know, I was a player. So, you know, no, without that stuff, I wouldn't have felt the things I felt that made me sit at a piano night after night, day after day, writing stuff, you know.
Did it help?
Well, it helped in as much as, it was kind of, well, when she hears this, it's all going to be okay, you know.
Mm-hmm. Really? Is that what you thought?
I did, yeah. Foolish, huh? But, I mean, I did.
Did you get over it?
There's various people in your life that you never quite get over. I mean, that's kind of the cliche. And then, you know, sometimes, I mean, with me, for example, because of children, you are morally obligated, and you need, because if you want to be with the kids as much as possible, you have to be in touch with this person that's really hurt you. So it's not like, you know, you can just walk away and leave without a trace, because, you know, in this instance, there's a couple of little guys that are looking up to you saying, what am I going to do, Dad?
Okay, there are so many crazy things about this. First of all, even Phil Collins can't help but quote Phil Collins. Second, if it hadn't been for his wife leaving him in 1979, Phil Collins would never have become Phil Collins. Heartbreak turned a jazz rock fusion drummer into an international pop icon. But the other crazy thing was how honest and normal he was about it. Once again, Phil Collins put into words what I was feeling. There was a part of me, and it is not a small part, that wants my ex, Anthony, to hear the song I write and ask to come back.
He did not come back. He did not come back. Every once in a while, I get like a tweet. The story is like pretty old now. And I get a tweet, and people are just like, how's Anthony? Did he ever talk to you? And I'm just like, if you ever want to forget your ex, don't do a story on the radio. Because people like really like to just like, they it's fresh. But he never came back, and as far as I know, he's never. I say at the end that he is not going to listen to it, and I. From what I've been told, I was right, and he's never listened to it, which I feel like a strange satisfaction about, like, being so right about that. Also, people think that Phil Collins, they think that he, I've heard people say that yeah, if you're on This American Life, you can get anyone to talk to you. But he really did not know what This American Life was. Like, he first of all, like, the friend who had put us in touch was also named Anthony. And for a while, when I first talked to him, Phil Collins was like, am I being punked? Like, he really agreed to talk to me because I was, like, so pathetic in the email, I think. I was so heartbroken and wounded that I think he was just like, I'm going to help her. He's great. And I have not, we emailed a few times afterwards, but then I realized at some point there's a guy named Jesse Thorne. He's got a radio show, and Jesse Thorne had done was interviewing him, and I ran into Jesse, and he's like, I'm gonna go do a, he told me that he had just interviewed him, and I guess he brought me up to Phil Collins, and Phil Collins said, so it turns out, I used to send the, like, mass emails. I've stopped doing it because it stresses me out so much, but I used to, like, send mass emails, and I would not go through my email addresses because I would, like, I'd have to admit certain people weren't in my life, so I would just, like, just send every address that I had, and Phil Collins told Jesse, yeah, she's a nice girl. I get her email sometimes about subletting her apartment. And so I guess he was on my, like, he was on that list. So for a while I did personal stories, but it's really interesting. Like, it was like what was so natural in the beginning, but then I began to realize it was getting harder and harder to do them. Like, they weren't like forming naturally anymore. And I really realized this when I did this one story on this episode of Kid Politics. And I grew up in this suburb of LA called Whittier, and it's where Richard Nixon's from. It's like the only two things that have ever happened is there was an earthquake and Richard Nixon was from there, which is kind of like a similar confluence. And when I was little, the Nixon Library opened, and H.R. Halderman came to the library. School went on a field trip there when it opened, and H.R. Halderman, who was Nixon's chief of staff, and like pled guilty and went to jail for went to prison for for the wiretapping. He, I think, or for lying. He talked to us, and we were like all little kids, and told us of his innocence, like pled his innocence to us. And it's like a very vivid memory. And the Nixon Library is a really weird place where it was like a privately owned museum, and everything was like trying to clear Nixon's name. So you would like listen to weird recordings that they'd edited of the wires, like try to make everything about his innocence. And it's not a typical presidential library. And so I'd heard that Ronald Reagan Library was having this special exhibit starting about where there was gonna be, little kids could go and reenact the invasion of Grenada. And so I thought I would go, and that would kind of be the top. That would kind of be like the little color around my main story of H.R. Halderman's visit. But then when I started doing it, I was actually having like a really hard time connecting with my, like, again, like telling a story over. Like, I realized it was a story that I had told. Like, ever since I went into This American Life, it was like on the story list, but I was like forgetting what was interesting about it. And it's in there, but it's not really, that is the stuff that's kind of like tapes everything together, but it's not the main story. Because what ended up happening was I went to the museum and just watched what, like a group of kids for the day, like three different classes come and go through the exhibit. And it was unlike any story I've ever done, because really all I did was watch the kids and then observe what was happening. And I realized that's like a whole other way of telling like my version of an original story, because it was just all based on observations. And also just kind of getting out of the story's way and letting the story take its natural course, because things happen in the course of the day that I was just watching. But there was a natural arc that formed. And I'm going to play you some of that. And first of all, what I was going to say about the breakup story, when I listened to that, I could never do that story now. Like, I would never be able to be, because I recorded it right after that breakup happened, like what's captured in my voice and my feelings, it's a time capsule of my emotions back then. And I really, what's interesting about radio is I think if you miss that, you can't kind of fake it. And I did a election podcast in the run-up to the election. It was a limited series where two friends and I placed actual bets on what was going to happen because we were trying to deal with our stress. It was before the trauma. It was just stress at the time. And that was the most interesting. I had never done a weekly show. And we were doing it, and it was like, we were very stressed out and very anxious, but it was a funny show. And then in real time, this huge upset happened. And then we recorded the episode the day after, or the last episode. It was always supposed to end the day after the election. And we recorded that the day after. And I was gonna maybe play you guys some of that, and I'm like, I can't do this to these people. Like, it's so sad. But I do find it really interesting how much audio, just by the sake of what it is, captures what you're feeling at the time and how there is, you can miss it, you can wait too long. And it's a big lesson I've learned along the way. So coming back to politics, you're gonna hear this. I was listening to it again to play for you guys. It is so weirdly, it really applies to what's happening in our current situation, and I did not intend that at the time, but I've also learned in radio there's a lot of like history repeating itself, so keep that in mind. Oh, and I wanted to tie it back to senses theme. So when you're listening to this, try to like, I guess kind of, it's not like homework or anything, but take note on how visual it feels, because there's a lot of movement. But I feel like you can really get a sense of the space just by listening.
Grenada is what color? Okay, everyone tell me.
Red.
Very good, it's red. That means it's a communist country.
The kids go on to talk about the rebels who overthrew the Grenadian government in 1983, and about the group of 800 or so American medical students who were stranded there, and who became instant pawns in U.S. Cold War politics.
But why do we really care about what's going on in Grenada? There's a specific reason why we're so concerned, specifically why President Reagan was concerned. Yes, sir.
Because they might have joined armies and take over the U.S.
Okay. So we have Cuba, we have Grenada, and there's also Nicaragua at the time that are all communist, and they're kind of close to the United States. So it could be that it causes a problem from the United States if they were to come to us and want to maybe make us communist, right?
That's right. We were afraid. Cuba, Grenada, and Nicaragua, with their collective population of 13 million, would come over, defeat the largest military in the world, and turn us all communist. And then, just in case there's any doubt in the kids' minds about how terrible this would be, a staff member gives them a quick primer on the evils of communism.
Very good. In a communist country, you have limited rights and freedoms. If you wanted to go and get a job and earn a living, could you keep your money? Could you? Who has all the money in a communist country? What do you think?
The government.
The government, very good. Now, if you wanted to buy some land, or you wanted to buy a home, you wanted to buy property, could you do that in a communist country? Who owns all the property? Everyone.
The government.
Very good.
The reason for all this studying is that the kids are going to reenact the invasion. The class is divided up, with one-third playing members of the Oval Office, one-third playing the press, and one-third playing the military. And one kid will play Ronald Reagan himself. The staff begins to hand out badges, designating which kid is what.
Secretary of State, Nicolette Schultz.
The military commanders are next, followed by the press. The naming of one little girl as White House bureau chief prompts a classmate to mutter, "I knew it," under his breath. I ask him why, and he tells me that one time when they were in kindergarten, she played a news anchor, so his voice trails off. Without fail, the kids ooh and ah over every position that is called out. The kids are ushered to a room with three closed doors. The library is really fancy. Flat-screen TVs flash on, and actors playing nondescript officials explain the kids' mission and the potential consequences of their actions.
When you walk through these doors, you will no longer be students.
You will make history.
Lives are at stake.
Adult staff members are not here to answer questions or help you. The responsibility is entirely yours.
President Reagan, please report to the Oval Office and find your desk.
The three doors swing open in unison, revealing three different sets: the Oval Office, the press room, and the command center of a battleship. Everyone goes to their assigned room. The battleship is amazing. It's dimly lit with lots of flashing lights and a gadget with toggle switches in front of every chair. And if there's anything a kid loves, it's toggle switches.
Welcome to the Command Decision Center.
Whoa!
Oh my God!
Oh my Jesus!
Press Corps is led through another door. A staff member flat out lies to them by telling them that the press room is every bit as exciting as a battleship. It looks like a hotel conference room. The best selling point the staff can muster is that the room is large.
In fact, the press room is bigger than the press room in the White House, so that's pretty exciting.
The president and his cabinet head into a replica of the Reagan-era Oval Office, complete with a jar of jelly beans on the desk, which the kids are instructed to not even think about eating.
Secretary Weinberg.
Today's President Reagan is a blonde fifth grader with an athletic build. My guess is he's a popular kid, but a benevolent one. He seems to take being named leader of the free world in stride, as though it's the sort of thing that happens to him often. Here's how it all works. The invasion is broken down into a series of A or B options. For instance, A, have diplomatic talks with Grenada, or B, evacuate the medical students. A, evacuate the medical students, or B, overthrow the communist government. Each kid gets a vote, but President Reagan has final say.
Well, both of the options are, I considered both of the options, but I think a smaller, faster force, if they, let's say the smaller, faster force is overpowered, we have very small chances. If we have a big army coming there, then we have better chances and it will take quicker. So I go with A.
The president inputs his answer into a dramatic red phone located right next to the jelly bean jar on his desk. Before they start, the kids were told that there aren't right or wrong answers, but the whole thing's rigged to make what Ronald Reagan did in 1983 look like the most appealing option. Each time the kids choose to do what he did, a bell goes off as though they've won a tropical vacation in Grenada instead of an invasion.
Nicely done. That is another correct response according to President Reagan.
Excellent work, President. Ordering a large invasion ensured that we would get the job done.
Again and again, President Reagan makes the same decisions as, well, President Reagan. Everything is going great until there's a news flash. Apparently the kids in the press room have been hard at work. An actress playing a reporter appears on the screen.
All right, I'm not sure what this is. Let's take a look.
Confidential sources tell this reporter that two U.S. aircraft carriers headed to Lebanon have been rerouted to Grenada.
Wait a minute, how did they get this
Independence
information?
And the USS Guam
carrying
a large number of Marines.
Not yet.
Any
of you talk to the press?
Sources say this will be more than
this is top secret information. I'm not sure how the press got this story, but this is going to cause some problems for us.
Here's how it went down. In real life, 1983, the press was somehow tipped off about the story in Grenada. President Reagan and the military had been planning a surprise attack, and so when the news got out, they had to decide whether to go ahead with the invasion, even though Grenada would be waiting for them, or to abort. President Reagan, again, like his predecessor, President Reagan, decides to stick with the plan. The red phone dings. The U.S. goes to war for 3 days. After it's over, the staff does a little debrief with everyone. They talk with the kids about what happened, pointing out how it was especially bad when they lost the element of surprise.
And how did we lose the element of surprise? What happened? Yes, sir.
Reporters somehow figured out the information that which was top secret and ruined the surprise.
All right, so President Reagan, now that we know that it's the reporters, we saw the report, what are you going to do to them for releasing this information?
The staff asked the kids if the press had a right to tell the public. They go over the nuts and bolts of what freedom of the press means and decide that what the reporters did was legal.
They can't have any consequences for what they did. However, just because they have the freedoms, do all of you think that they should have used that freedom today?
No. No.
Now, we did lose some military lives. I'm here to inform you that we lost 19 soldiers in the fighting. Now, we can't directly say that's because of the press, but did it help that they released the story?
No,
it certainly didn't help.
No one points out that those 19 soldiers might have lived if the Oval Office had done things differently. Or that invading countries is a dangerous business, and casualties tend to come with the territory. Instead, one by one, you can see it on the kids' faces, how it could have been perfect if only it wasn't for the press. And then the staff tells the kids they're going to rejoin their classmates, the ones that were in the other room, playing reporters.
Now it is time for me to take you into the press room for a press conference. That means you're going to see the press. I ask you to be polite, but point out to them that maybe their actions had some consequences today.
Come on in. Did you guys see her story? Did you like her story?
No.
What?
Like that.
So you guys saw her story, but you didn't like it?
No!
You destroyed our plan.
You destroyed our plan.
We destroyed your plan?
Yes!
Everyone is trying to get in as much glaring and as much head shaking as possible.
19 for 800.
The phrase element of surprise and 19 dead comes up again and again and again. The kids seem genuinely upset.
I don't understand. What plan did we destroy?
Because.
One representative, yes.
Well, the reason why we really didn't want it to go out was because if they didn't know, we would still have the 19 and we would still have it just, it ruined our plan of action.
It's a strange experience, watching little kids struggling to become adults before their time. They were too young to understand exactly what had just happened, but old enough to feel guilt about the blood on their hands. It surely must have been the first time in their lives that they'd been accused of causing a person's death, and yet they took to it so naturally.
Weird, right? The kids in the press room are fully, like, everyone is so sequestered from each other too, like they're not prepared at all for what, they just think they're going on like a fun field trip. And then later on in the story, another kid plays Reagan, and he's like Obama, and he's like this very thoughtful kid who like kind of talks, in the same kind of cadence, like he talks very thoughtfully and considers every word, and he ends up not making the same decision, and this buzzer goes off. Even though there's no right and wrong answer, a buzzer that clearly indicates wrong, and then everyone, like, that kid was scarred for life. Like, he was just out in the parking lot at the end being like, actually thinking that he had killed those soldiers. So you see how it all happens. But I feel like this story was really fun to do, and I think it was an important one for me personally when I was doing it, because I saw how much I could, how sometimes you can tell a story by kind of nudging, you're highlighting the moments, right? You're letting the story take its course and you're highlighting the moments. And also, I really liked that I was watching these, that I had gone into the story thinking I was going to tell one story about myself, and then it actually, the natural story took over and led me. And I didn't know any of that was going to happen, and I really liked how surprised I was. And I liked that I was watching these kids kind of like experience this unnatural rite of passage for the first time, but it was like happening. And I realized the more, the more I thought about what I wanted to do with audio stories, I realized it wasn't exactly like my taste had evolved, but they had just, I was at a different point than when I had started, which I think is good. I think you shouldn't just keep doing the same thing. And for a few years, I actually didn't do any radio, really. Like, I did this story, but I didn't do that many other ones. And in that time, I had this idea to do, I got really into mysteries. And I got into mysteries before I had the idea to do a show about mysteries, because I actually wasn't even very interested in doing my own show. I knew I didn't want to do another, I didn't want to do a show that was like This American Life, because I feel like This American Life did it very well. So I didn't want to do another one. But I really liked just the genre of mysteries. And I started kind of thinking about what that show would be. And I realized that the reason I was so drawn to it was because it was just like a whole other phase of telling a story where I didn't, like, really had no idea what was going to happen. Like, at least with this one, like, there was a framework. I knew that I would go to the museum and hopefully something would happen, but it was like I knew what the basic story was. With mysteries, all I know is the case, but I have every single thing else is up to chance, and whether I can tell the story is up to chance, because
my own rules that I established about my show, Mystery Show. It's called Mystery Show, in case you guys don't know. I don't mean to presume. I also presumed all you guys didn't vote for Trump, but I'm going to keep presuming that. So my rule that I established, because I don't like to make anything easy, I guess, and it's not bragging, because I think it's frustrating for myself that I make up rules that are hard and I'm not allowed to break them. But my rule was I had to like solve the case. If I was going to do a show about mysteries, I don't like mysteries that don't have an ending, or there's two kinds of endings I don't like. I don't like the answer that you least suspect, and I also don't like it when it seems like they're going to solve it and they don't. You can not solve it, but I don't like it when it's like kind of lead you to believe that it's going to be a different thing. So I made up this rule that I'm going to take cases and they're going to have to be solved. And the criteria for the cases was that they were going to be people's personal mysteries, because again, I wanted them to be stories that nobody had ever told before. And like, I realized that a good way to tell stories that no one's ever told before is like you just get really, really micro. Like you get as small as possible. And so like the cases I have, no one's ever told them because like you can't, I don't know if you can do a story about why Britney Spears is carrying a book unless it's framed like a mystery. You know, like it's not a story, but it was the client Andrea's, you know, a very big passion in her life. It was not small to her, but it was small enough that it had gone under the radar of all the reporters of the world. And so I was able to get it, and I really liked that. I really liked the idea of taking a small thing and treating it with the exact same seriousness you would treat, you know, a murder case or a criminal investigation, because to these people who are the clients, it is that big. And the other thing I realized as I was making Mystery Show was that I really liked when you're doing radio, like if you notice that story I just played, like there's a lot of movement. Like we're literally moving through the room, and we're moving, you know, from one room to the other room, and things are happening. So time is moving, but also there's physical movement. And I feel like movement is a very big part of compelling radio. It's the difference between someone telling you an anecdote that they're really good at telling, even if they're great at it, and someone telling you something that they're not used to telling and that you've never heard. So like with my cases, I didn't even know the cases before I did the interview, because I didn't want any of it to feel staged. And so there's one case I did where I'm hearing, my friend had told me he had a mystery like 2 years before I was doing Mystery Show. And he just said two words. And then I was like, wait, don't tell me until I have a show. And then 2 years passed, and he never told me. And so when you hear him tell me right now, I know these clips are a little long, this one's shorter, but when you hear him tell me right now, it's the very first time I've ever heard any of it. You can feel the difference, I think, than if we had planned this out before.
Okay, so what two words do you know about my mystery?
Belt buckle.
That is a good title for it.
That's Carson. He knew me even before I was solving mysteries. That's how far back we go. When you have a mystery, you carry it around with you always. Usually, that happens in your head. But in Carson's case, his mystery fits in the palm of his hand. It's an object that came into his life when he was 9 years old in Phoenix, Arizona.
There was this kid in our neighborhood named Jimmy Turk, who was like maybe a year older than my brother, who's 2 years older than me. He was like a troublemaker. I wouldn't go so far as to call him a bad kid, but like, you know, he had a single mom, so he could get away with more stuff than me and my brother, because she had to work. And so he just had a lot of unsupervised time.
Likeable, affable troublemaker.
Yeah, good guy.
Yeah.
He never really did anything that bad, you know? It was just like, I remember he had like found a stick of dynamite somewhere, and he'd emptied out all the gunpowder.
From the stick of dynamite?
Supposedly. The stick of dynamite was never seen, just the gunpowder was seen. One day, I went over to Jimmy's house, and he showed me this belt buckle that he'd found in the gutter. That was what he said. He went for a walk, and he found it in the gutter. And it's beautiful. On the front of it, there's a chef's hat front and center, flanked by a corkscrew, a pan of eggs that are frying, and a toaster. And the pan of eggs, the like eggs are painted, you know, like very carefully with some kind of enamel. So they're like yellow and white. And this is the coolest part of it. You ready?
Yeah.
That is the toaster.
No.
Yeah, there's a tiny, tiny switch. And if you flick the switch, the toast pops up.
Doesn't that click everything? Could you picture it when you, I mean, first of all, you're picturing it wrong. But can you picture something when you hear it? It's amazing. It looks, I mean, what you're picturing is amazing, and it looks a different kind of amazing. It is so good. But I didn't know any of that. And he kept just unfurling more and more delicious details that I couldn't handle. And then I got the phone and I knew, okay, that's 100% a mystery. I didn't have any doubt it was gonna work. And everything about that story, from the minute he told that to me, like, I saw the shape of it. Like, even though there was so much unknown, everything was unknown. There's two names on the belt buckle. On the front it says Hans Jordi, on the back it says Bob Six. And Hans Jordi is who he assumed the belt buckle's owner was, and I didn't know if he was alive. I didn't know anything about this man other than three things that I found online, like three kind of cryptic, very disparate things about him. But I still had total faith it was gonna work out or be a story. I didn't know what was gonna happen or if it was gonna have a happy ending or a sad ending, but I knew I could feel a narrative to it because of how, first of all, how good that buckle was and how convinced I was that he wanted to return it. Like, it really felt like this just had to happen. There's a reason this story has to happen, and there's a reason that this man's got his belt buckle back. And like, it wasn't just, I mean, I could have just returned his belt buckle, but I also felt like the facts of Hans's life just felt so much like a story that it actually did feel like this man's story had to be told, and nobody else was gonna tell. I'm not flattering myself, but I'm saying like, it's just that I found my form, you know? And once you find your form, things come a lot easier and you're able to like figure out a way to tell stories in a way that I think that was the luckiest thing that could happen, was that mysteries just clicked and felt so right. Do you guys know that story? Do you want to? I could tell anyone what happens if you've not heard it, but you can also just listen. Yes.
Oh. I haven't heard it. I'd like to hear it.
Well, you can't. I'm not gonna play. I was gonna tell. I didn't want to ruin the ending. I can tell you. I'll tell you more afterwards. Okay. Okay. And then I realized the other thing. So the thing that's challenging about Mystery Show is that. Because I don't know anything going into it, it's very scary. The deeper I get into it and the better the details are and the better the mystery is, it makes me very stressed out because it might never see the light of day. And there's been lots of mysteries at this point that probably will never be heard because there's no path to solve them. And as much as I try to find a way, I've thought really hard, is there a way to tell a mystery without solving it? But it just kind of evaporates whenever I try that. Like, there's something about it that feels like it has to reach its natural end. So I feel like the way I get movement is in lots of ways. So there's the me not knowing what the mystery is, and then there's the actual investigation, which is very active, and me on the trail for clues. There's a part where there's a mystery about why Britney Spears had this very obscure book. And in the middle of it, I call up Ticketmaster. I can play that clip if you guys want to hear it. But do you guys want to hear it? It's a long, okay. I'll play some of it. I was looking for Britney Spears for this to figure out where this, she had this book that was very, very obscure. I'll play you the beginning so you can hear it. It's not long, I promise.
I have a Google setting myself.
This is the client.
Because I'm a Kardashian.
Mm-hmm. As do I.
It's important.
Yeah.
And I got a Google alert one morning in 2008 from this website, and they had a picture of Britney Spears coming out of a restaurant in Malibu. And she's exiting the back door of the restaurant, and there's kind of paparazzi in it. And she's holding this collection of very intimate things,
mm-hmm.
her pack of cigarettes, and then her phone pressed to the cigarettes, and then her lighter. And then she's got my second book. And I just lost my mind. I really went nuts. When I get really, really excited, I don't know what to do with myself. I can't believe I have a body that I have to be responsible for. Like, what do I do? What do I do? And I just started emailing everybody I knew. I don't know if I've been this level of excited that many times in my life.
Were you as excited when you had your baby?
No.
She's very excited because she loves Britney Spears. It's unironic, her love for Britney Spears. It's very akin to my love of Phil Collins, although that started out ironically. Hers was never ironic. She loves her, and she's so honored that Britney's holding her book. And I would never have taken the case if someone was doing this. Like, if there was a whiff of irony, I would not have taken this case. But she sincerely wanted to know why Britney had it, if she liked it, if she didn't like it, what were her notes on how Andrea could have done better, all of it. She has different theories about why Britney has it, but there's one theory that was not in the final episode that we cut for like pacing, that this is like, I'm gonna play for you guys. So this is only here right now.
Do you have a theory as to how Britney got your book?
I imagine it being given to her by someone. I mean, I like to think, because I know she had gone out to dinner with Mel Gibson the week before. I love to think that Mel Gibson gave her this book, like, you really need to read this. I don't know why I like to think that. I guess because of all his issues with Jews, I like to think that maybe he embraced, like, a Jewess's book.
Could have been the other way, where he's just like, look at this book. You're gonna hate it. I was right about everything.
He's hate giving her.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, as long as we're entertaining all options here.
Hey there.
I don't even know what that is. I enjoy that theory. This is before she said that before Mel Gibson somehow is okay again. I don't get it, but that was there. Okay, so I was looking for Britney. I took on the case and I had to find Britney. And Britney is not easy to find because every second of her life is photographed by the paparazzi. She actually is very hard to get to because of all of her years of like the paparazzi getting too close. And so she's got like this, you know, like shield around her. No one lets you interview her. She seems very accessible on Instagram, but don't let it fool you. Like, it's hard. And I went to the mall that she's seen at all the time. And everyone I talked to had met her and interacted with her, but she was not there when I went there. And I had all these connections, and they all fell through. And so then I realized that I had to get, the only way to get to her was to pay $2,500 to go to Vegas and get a meet and greet with her. And I bought the ticket, and then realized I should probably call Ticketmaster and find out if I actually, you know, got to talk to her. It was a very scary purchase. So this is what happened when I called Ticketmaster. And the reason I wanted, I really feel like the heart of the show is in this conversation. And because as I was making the show, every mystery was so new and I had no idea what was gonna happen or even if the show was gonna work, I really was figuring out the formula, I hope it's not a formula, but the format as I was going along. And so like every time I talked to a person, I was like, oh, I guess this show is this. And this to me embodies, it's the way I thought of it was, I would just bought a ticket to see Britney for $2,500. People go buy that ticket blindly, and Britney, as much as I love her, has been deemed this like person who's worth $2,500. And then there's a person that you call who you tend to not want to spend any time with. And so, like, the whole irony of customer service is that
you like are trying so hard to get a human on the phone, and then as soon as you do, you just can't wait to get them off the phone. And so I feel like there's a certain world that makes sense to me about Mystery Show, and it's, and I'm really, the people who are in the show, I feel like all belong together, and I really like that it's kind of like just these people that we didn't quite know were out there. Like there's an expat, there's an, you know, European expat community of old men chefs in Arizona who, you know, cook and have belt buckles, magic belt buckles, and there's a whole world of like magic lunchbox design that's another mystery. But they all, I'm very conscious of it when making it, that these worlds are supposed to fit, and I kind of purposely leave out some. There's certain people that I feel like wouldn't be on the show because they're already, their stories are told enough, and I'm really interested in trying to tell the stories of people that you just, I don't even want to say you don't hear from because it makes me sound more noble than I am, but it's just, okay. So, she's making a thing. Okay, just, but I'm, you'll hear.
Thank you for calling Ticketmaster Fan Support. Are you calling about an existing order?
Yes.
Now you can say, change my delivery, refund my order. Or you can say, it's something else.
It's something else.
Okay, please hold while I transfer you to a representative.
Chasing down the days of fear, chasing down a dream before it disappears.
Hi, thank you for holding. This is Dennis with customer service. And may I ask who I have the pleasure of speaking with?
Starlee Kine.
And how are you doing, Miss Kylie?
Starlee, I'm good. How are you?
Oh, Starlee.
It's okay. It's a hard one. It's hard to get your...
Once when you see it, it's like, oh, yeah, it's like Starlee. But, yeah. I see that you do have one ticket for the Britney Spears, February 14th at 9 o'clock at Planet Hollywood in Las Vegas. And this is for the VIP meet and greet package. Everything that comes with it.
Yes. Can I ask you a few questions about it?
Yes, ma'am. Oh, I only know so much information, but what are we calling about?
I was wondering, do you know how long I get with her?
I don't actually have that information, ma'am.
Okay. Do you think maybe I could bring a book that she would sign?
You know, I wouldn't be able to guarantee it.
If you had to guess a genre of book that Britney Spears would read, what would you guess? This is what I'm going to ask her when I go. I think I get one question.
I would think you would get more than one question.
I know, right? For that amount of money? I know, you can say it. We can all agree this is a crazy amount of money to spend on this.
Yes.
Yes.
I do believe you actually have, like, the best VIP, if you would.
Oh, okay.
So that means it would come with the most amenities and everything.
So maybe I get two questions.
Quite possibly. Don't quote me on that.
Okay. So if one of my questions is, I want to ask her about this one book, but then what should my other question be, you think, if I get two? Well, what do you want to know?
Maybe like something about her success, to see if success changed her or if it's helped her. I mean, because, I mean, I've seen some of the stuff in the media, and I know, like, because she started off, you know, like, real successful and, like a role model for some people, or if you would, and then, you know, she's kind of had, like, that downslide, and then she kind of, like, picked herself back up, and now she's kind of, like, rising back up. So I would kind of ask, like, how it feels to be, like, that inspiration that, like, you know you can mess up and make mistakes and then go and change the way your life is.
Do you have role models in your life that inspire you?
Sort of. I mean, my mom would probably be the closest one. I mean, she did raise me and all my brothers by herself. I have six brothers total. And you know, my dad passed away when I was like five.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so she had to raise all of us. She had to work like two jobs and worked a lot. And when we all reminded her of my dad, and she loved my dad. And it takes a toll on you. Losing someone like that.
Do you remember him?
Slightly. Like, I remember, like, playing games, like, dog pile and stuff, and a couple of things like that.
You guys must have had a good dog pile if there were so many of you, right?
Yeah.
Are you the youngest?
I'm the second youngest, actually.
So you were pretty close to the top of the dog pile. Or the bottom. How does it work? The little ones get all piled on, right?
Yeah, it's just a random game. Sometimes you're at the top, sometimes you're at the bottom.
that's kind of like Britney, right? Sometimes she's at the top, sometimes she's at the bottom.
Yeah, I guess so.
It's like maybe life is just one big dog pile.
Wow.
Did I just blow your mind right
there?
That's
pretty deep. Yeah, like, wow. Okay. That is.
Are you being sarcastic or do you mean it? It's pretty deep.
Oh, no, for real. That's. I didn't even think of like how that applied when I said that. Sometimes at the top, sometimes at the bottom, and then you know, it refers to everything we were just talking about. Although I don't really think this applies to customer service.
I like to ask questions.
I got that feeling. I mean, that's a good thing, because, I mean, you're curious, and, mm-hmm. you know, more people should be curious about other people and just not focus on themselves. I mean, I believe that like, the purpose of life is each other, because if everyone cared about everyone else, then nobody would have to care about themselves. I mean, when I was younger, I got in a lot of trouble. You have to be the kind of person that you would want someone to be attracted to.
That's true, because if you're not, even if that person's attracted to you at first, if you don't believe that you're worthy of that person, they're not going to stay interested.
That's my problem right there in the show.
You don't think you're worthy?
In a sense, no.
You are. You have to believe that.
Yeah, but I've made a lot of mistakes, too.
Who hasn't? I think you think you're not going to get happiness, and so the only way you're going to be able to feel stuff is it's sad stuff.
Yeah. Uh-huh. You can get addicted to a certain kind of sadness. And what about you?
What about me?
What about you? You don't have any of those problems?
I do have those problems. That's why I'm able to talk about it, because I feel like I can relate. There's plenty of times I don't feel worthy, and I say mean things to myself, and I lose perspective, and I get depressed, and I totally understand. Mm-hmm. Everyone does, and that's why you have to start little bits telling yourself, I am worthy, I do deserve that, I'm just as good as the other person who's getting it. And so you just have to, like, trick yourself.
It's like subliminal messages to yourself.
Yeah. Act as though there's like commercials flashing at you that just keep being brought.
I mean, you're awesome.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I've worked here for about 8 months, and this is the most interesting phone call I've had ever.
Ever.
Ever. So you like go around changing other people's, you know, other customer services representatives' lives. Different companies and stuff. Is that what you do in your free time? Like, oh, I don't work today. Let me go change someone's life.
I just want you to feel worthy. Is that too much to ask? I'll be the first person to tell it to you, and then you can take it from there.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
So, there's lots of things I like about that. I love Dennis. I've not been able to find him since then. It's really sad. I only have his customer service number, and I've been tried to find him, but he couldn't give me his whole name. He knew I was recording. People asked me that. He knew all that. He knew I was using it. But I think part of the reason that this it's effective. A lot of people talk to me at that moment as being a moment that stands out for them in the show. And I like that because it, like what a lot of people say they're drawn to is just like the human connection part of it. And I want people to feel the urge to connect with other people. But I think the reason it feels the way it does is because you're also hearing our relationship unfold as you're listening. Like it's very active even though we're just on the phone. And it's because we just met each other. I did not know that was going to happen. I didn't know he was going to answer. I was just, you know, thought maybe I would get, like, maybe a joke of what Brittany reading. I had no idea. And then it was, we talked for a long time. We talked much longer than is in the show. And he was just great. And he, you know, like, we talked so long that he was going to go on his break, and he didn't go on his break. He kept, like, putting off going on his break, and then he told me what he had brought this. He gave me cooking tips, and we talked about his future, like, everything. He was really special, and
I think if I had prepared, there's no way to replicate that. If I had prepared, if I had gone in being like, oh, I hope to make a connection with a human being today, it wouldn't have worked. But because I think it was part of the advantage of not knowing what the show was too, I was so open to everything, and I wanted to try a new way of using audio so badly, and I just kind of, I was really determined to get out of the way of the story. Like as I started to take myself out of stories less, I saw other ways of telling stories come in very naturally. And there's nothing about me, like I'm the, you know, the detective character in the show, but I never, there's only one time I even tell a personal story, and it starts at the very beginning of the first episode. And then from that point on, it's just me interacting with people. And I'm very present, but I'm also, it's like I'm not, you know, it's not like I'm just trying to like tape them without comment. Like I have a lot of observations I'm making, but I feel like it's more of a shared experience because I'm learning so much from them, and I have to pay attention so much because I don't know what's going to happen at any time, and I need to let the story unfold, or you would feel my like hand in it if I messed with it. I don't think you would have that feel. So that's kind of where I am in my creative process. There's one more thing I wanted to say. I feel like I'm always looking for a like mysteries was my thing that kind of unlocked something. But I feel like I was just talking to a friend. We went on a walk, and we were both talking about how I'm really into this movement thing. Like I always have good ideas when I'm walking my dog, and we were walking our dogs together. And she was talking about how she'd felt stuck, and she's from Louisiana, and she goes to Mardi Gras every year because she says she goes there to center herself, and she feels like herself again when she goes, and she's begun to like kind of track her life and how many Mardi Gras do I have left. And I just thought that was really important to know what the thing is that reminds you of what you want to be making. And I'm constantly kind of looking for that. I mean, it was mysteries, maybe it still is, but I feel like it was a really good way of putting it, and I wanted to impart that. So that's it. Thank you.
Listening to you talk to the gentleman from Ticketmaster, mm-hmm. So it's spontaneous. It's happening in the moment, as you were talking mm-hmm. about. And you're telling personal things and you're asking personal things at the same time. And I've listened to you for quite a while, and you seem to have a gift for being gentle and empathetic, but I was sort of wondering if that's something that comes with practice or something you have to watch. I heard Ira Glass tell a story once. I think he'd watched one of his most cringeworthy stories.
Uh-huh.
He'd walked onto the set of MASH, I believe, and he was interviewing Harry Morgan, who'd been a character actor and an excellent character actor forever, and he kept, Ira was green, and he kept hammering, well, why haven't you been a leading actor? And just kind of kept going at him, not understanding that those roles weren't available to him, and he just felt like an ass afterwards.
Yeah.
But how do you sort of manage that as you go?
I mean, I think, honestly, learning from Ira when I was so young, or, you know, I was like, the first, I was right out of college when I started working for This American Life. So I think I was that baseline of empathy was instilled in me from the beginning, like the empathy to the people you're interviewing. And there was a whole, I feel like This American Life has a way of, they just really believe in, if they're not, there's no gotcha-ness to them. Like if people will talk to you for a long time, and your role, at least from This American Life, from what I took from it, and I've talked about it with people there, is that like you are sometimes you're not trying to look for their embarrassing moments. You're trying to use the tape that elevates them. That is the way that they actually are, but not everyone can be like that every second. And so I feel when I'm going into a conversation, I both truly believe that you should listen to your customer service representative, but I think when I'm doing mystery show, I'm like the best version of myself. It is me, but I'm not like that always in my life. But I feel like it is what I believe, it's what I want to be, and it's what I believe people should be. And so that makes it easier to want to, you know,
to want to, it makes it easier to listen. The empathy is a given, I feel. Like, if you're interviewing someone, it should be, like, you have to be. Like, they're giving you, they're helping you. And, like, there's just, like, a baseline of respect that I think should be there. But I think also, I don't know, it feels, like, even with Dennis, like, I wanted to hear him. Like, I didn't want to talk about myself. I end up talking about myself when I realize that he kind of wants me to, you know, because he doesn't want to feel alone and, like, he's embarrassed. But, like, there's no urge. Every time I've ever interviewed someone and then I suddenly insert myself, it feels so strange and you notice it right away. And so I think I am tuned into social stuff. Maybe, I think that is, I'm aware of that, but I think everything else, I think I'm lucky that This American Life taught me that lesson, that we are supposed to be helping the people that we interview instead of hoping that they say something that we can make fun of them for. Did that answer your question?
It did. I was struck by the Reagan Museum story. And one of the questions that came to me that would apply to all these stories is, when you're in the midst of one, is there a moment where you go, it moved from anecdote and observation to story and meaning? Like, for instance, I think about that one, I think, well, it could be about how absurd this museum mm-hmm. and their tour guides are, but no, it became for you about when do kids have to face up to being mm-hmm. adults before their time, et cetera, that sort of thing. Have you identified that in your craft when the moment comes?
I think I can identify it if I'm not bored. Like, if I feel super present in when I'm getting taped, because it can be a long process. Sometimes things go on for a long time. And if I feel excited when it's happening, that tends to be a good sign that it's a story. But then, like with the Reagan one, it went from being like, this is so much crazier than I thought it was gonna be. And then without doing anything, this whole arc formed, because when this other kid came, the contrast of him with the first Reagan, the two Reagans were so different that it just, maybe, I mean, I think I'm, probably because of working in This American Life, like I can tell when a narrative is happening, like I can see the shape forming, but I tend to gauge whether it's a story that I can keep going on by this excitement level. And there's been, like, I know with Mystery Show, I made the pilot for it like 2 years before the show came out, and I stayed excited, so that's also how I know to keep forcing myself to go back to a story that I, you know, want to give up on.
I was wondering, so you talk a lot about comparing your personal experience to like the experience of others and telling your personal story compared to telling other people's story. So one thing I've noticed is mysteries, everyone fears the unknown. And one thing that you do is you help people find what the unknown is, and it gives some people a sense of, you know, security. So I'm wondering, through your journey of your art, how have you grown as a person, or how have you watched your personal experience grow, like going through relationships with other people, just from kind of transferring from telling your story to telling others?
Well, I definitely think I became less interested in myself. I was never not interested in other people, but I feel like now I have almost no interest in myself, and so that's changed. But I think also, there's more of an innocence when I tell stories that is also me, and I think part of Mystery Show was to show that there's this wonder that we don't know about, and I think I need to be reminded of that as much as I need, and I'm trying to remind other people. So I think when I find myself, I don't know if my personal development has been, I don't think it's parallel, or I don't think it matches with my like creative growth. I don't like that word, but you know. But I think I want it to match more, so I think I kind of dip more into telling stories when I'm feeling like I need it, because I think I'm not quite as optimistic as my radio persona is, but I think it's also a side of myself that I'm trying to get to.
And I will say I've been thinking a lot about how to do mystery show kind of now, the way I kind of feel the direction the country is going in right now. And it's been an interesting thing to think about just how to find wonder in the midst of all this. Yeah.
So I have two questions. One, how long till mystery show two, season two? And two, do you have any stories? You mentioned a few stories that kind of failed or didn't really find its full ending. Were there any kind of interesting stories you'd like to share?
Or mysteries?
Mysteries that just never got resolved. That I'm sure some of them were really interesting. That you could.
Yeah, I mean there was. I mean, I'm always like with mysteries. I'm always trying. Sometimes I'm hesitant to talk about them because I'm always like they could still be solved, and they just seem like cold cases. I have no answer for season two. Yeah. Second season was definitely the mysteries are somehow harder to solve than the first season. The first season was this like miraculous period of time where like everything I tried just worked, and I really felt like it was. It sounds very corny, but it felt like I was supposed to be making this show because it was just like one after another. I had this magical trip where I saw Belt Buckle and Britney and I Love 9/11 all like on the same trip to like the Southwest, and it was the best. And so, I don't know. I do believe at this point I've made enough stories to be like, stories do kind of guide you though. So I'm trying to figure out why the story is not guiding me the same way it did with season one. But I'm trying to think of any I can share, mysteries that, well, there was one, this girl, I saw, this one I can't, I isn't a mystery because I solved it too soon. A girl wrote to me and said she had seen, I wonder if I have, She had grown up in this small town, and her family never went to the movies, and so it was a really notable occurrence when she went, and so she remembers every time. And they went to the movies, and they saw the movie Elf, and they thought it was so funny, and they loved all the parts of it. And then later on, they ended up buying it on like DVD and watching it at home. And this one part was missing, and it was the part where Elf, after he wins the lottery, goes to New York, or is in New York, and he buys a giant loft, and it's filled with a trampoline and like a thing with all the balls in it and pinball machines. And a woman, Zooey Deschanel, stays over, and she asks if she can stay over, and he goes, okay, but I get the top. And she goes, and he realizes that she actually means he meant the bunk beds, not I get the top. And she was really amazed because she couldn't understand why her like 9-year-old self could make up that joke. But when she watched Elf again, it wasn't in there. And I called her, and she was in the girl who sent me the case, and she was in Guatemala volunteering for the Peace Corps. And I made her go to an internet cafe, and I called her up, and I was like, "It's the movie Big. You have it wrong. It's the movie Big." And I like hung up. Were you guys figuring that out as I was saying it? But I made her call me. I was like, "You get on the phone. We're gonna clear this up right now."
So I'm dying to know, just because I know the story occurred a while ago. Did Phil Collins have an AOL email address? And if not, what was his email provider?
He didn't. Did he have AOL? I'm trying to remember. It was something like that. I mean, I probably have it somewhere. Like, I mean, it's in. If I don't know if I. I mean, I still have it. It's probably still his thing. I don't think it was AOL though. I think it was something. I don't think I have what. I'm not on Wi-Fi. But it wasn't his name. It wasn't like Phil Collins 123 or anything like that. But it was like that kind of provider, and he didn't know. We had to send him. He couldn't, I mean, this is before podcast explosion, so maybe he knows how to listen now, but I had to deliver a CD to his house. I had his address, and so I sent it to his house, and he was really nice about it. He thought it really turned out well. But I know he did not know This American Life at the time, because I think he for a long time thought it played on like a college radio show. Like even afterwards, and I would write to him and I'd be like, people like it so much, you're so, and I never wanted to be like, they like you now, they didn't like you before. Not, he's fantastic and everyone should have always liked him, but I feel like he never wanted anything more from me, which I thought was so, like he didn't want to promote anything, nothing. It's a wonderful, wonderful man. Yeah.
I was wondering, like, what is your process for selecting mysteries? Do you know?
Do you have your questions written down?
Yeah, because I forget them the moment I come up with them. I have to write them down, otherwise I forget. I've always been
that
way.
That's good.
But like, how do you know if a mystery that comes to you is going to make a good story? Like, just like you've been on radio, so like you know what a good radio story sounds like.
I do, but I feel like everything I learned, like it's such weird, mystery shows made it so like everything that I thought was once interesting, it's very confusing. Like everything just went out the window. I don't know, there's just like a certain, This American Life we used to talk about when people would, it was really hard when I was there at least, for people to know what to pitch, and we couldn't understand why. Like, they would pitch stuff that was so wrong for the show, and I'd be like, just listen to the show, and then you will know. And then people would, and they still couldn't feel it, and we would just know by tone. And mystery show has that feeling too. I don't know why. It's like I know Britney Spears fits in the world of mystery show, but Taylor Swift doesn't. Like, I'm sure of it. Like, it's a fact, but I can't, I could go, you know, at great length and tell you why, but I just know it right away. Jake Gyllenhaal probably fits and Ryan Gosling doesn't. But I think I need, now when people send mysteries, like it has to be, some of them are too small. Like even though I know that they mean something to the person and I believe it, it's like somehow it doesn't, I can't feel like the world's gonna expand, and all the mysteries in the first season, they start out small and they get bigger, and I think that was an important criteria. Sometimes like people have sent me, I've tried it with listeners sending me stuff, and that's been really tricky because, I don't know, like everyone in season one was my friend, and it made for this comfort that I think, that familiarity was really good to start, and I think it allowed me to go talk to strangers in a way that if a person I've never talked to, both they're pretty nervous when they talk to me, and that comes across, you're doing great, but like that comes across in the kind of client interview, and they're not sometimes as aware of their own, like sometimes they'll tell me stuff about their family, and like I'm like, this could go to a dark place that you might not be ready for, in a way that my friends who kind of like tell stories for a living would be more prepared, and I feel just a protective level to that. And I don't know, I feel like Mystery Show isn't telling those stories yet. And I don't want it to become This American Life. There's a thing, is like I there's a lot of things where I bump and I'll be like, that would be a good This American Life story. That could be a good Radiolab story, but it just doesn't fit. And I only have 6 stories as my model, so it is actually kind of tricky. I do know there's something about just this scrappy underdog feeling that I do feel, I recognize right away. Like when I heard about all those chefs in Arizona, I was like, absolutely. And it was like, in my mind, I have this map with there's different pins on it of all these little communities that have been unearthed, and those make sense to me. So I think if I heard about those, I would know.
Yeah. It's my favorite podcast, so.
Oh, thank you. You did a good job. Yeah.
All right, I think you're our last one.
That's convenient. I have like 4 questions. I wrote them all down. But then I remembered them. But with that preface in mind, feel free to disregard whatever questions you like. So with respect to season 2, I'm wondering, do you have a cold case, since you're just outrageously famous now, do you have a cold case file that you could put on your website and say, I've hit a dead end on this? You know, dear giant world of information, if somebody has a quiet lead that they could slip our way, that would be handy. And then we could get season 2 sooner. But when I tell stories, they're inevitably terrible. And I've come to realize the reason is I always include completely inconsequential information and exclude the interesting stuff. So I, in listening to the Lunchbox story, the Phil Spector story like just blew my mind, and I loved it, and it was outrageous and wonderful, but 100% tangential to the core story. Mm-hmm. How do you know what to include and what to exclude so that I can have friends?
Okay, that's a good... Are you doing it on purpose when you when you get rid of the interesting and...
No. It's a character.
Yeah. I've thought about the opening it up to listeners. I've thought about it. There was one case that I was like, that's going to be the one that people can help with, but I feel like it can only happen. I wish I had done it at the end of season one. I wish I had thought that would have been a good way to end it with everyone, all of you guys having a project to work on instead of having to tweet at me and ask me when the show's coming back. If I do it, it would have to be exactly the right case and for the right reason. Because otherwise it feels like there's something, the stories just do not work unless I solve them. I have tried and I see them collapse around me. And I also sabotage them. Like my writing's not as good, my tape's not as good, I do a bad editing job. Like I'm resisting it with all of my being. And so I have to listen to that. For you telling why do you but how can you recognize but can you recognize when some you can recognize an interesting story but are you picking up on social cues?
Yes.
How do you know?
My wife.
She's your friend?
She's my wife.
But are you his friend? Does he do that? Does he drive people away? Is it because he's not picking up on social cues?
No, I pick up on them, but either the story has to stop right there, mm-hmm. or because
she's handing you the mic.
So the story has to stop right there because I've done so terribly, and I recognize that like I've lost my audience, even if it's an audience of one, they're gone.
But right? Why don't you stop the story earlier?
Because
you're not listening to people. You have to listen to people. Does he listen to you?
The mic.
He doesn't listen? You want him to listen more?
I just let him go. That's what
Why?
Because that's what
we can't do that anymore. We can't do that anymore. We have to stop. We can't. We have to be heard. No. You have to let your voice be heard.
Or I have to stop letting my voice be heard.
Well, you have to get. You have to. Put the ego aside and let, it's not because you're an ego, it's because you're nervous and so you don't know how to stop. You don't know how to stop and you kind of like, it's your comfort zone getting into that trap and thinking that people, it's you know what you're doing, you're using it as a crutch. You're making it so that you don't have to change your ways because it's easier to be like this.
Thank you, Starlee.
Yeah.